AKA Ranger Raspberry on the radio. And I also go by La Pachamami. My preferred gender pronouns are she and they. What are yours?
I prefer they, but I accept all, depending on what my mood and outfit is.
Ooh, I like that.
Cool. So today we're here to talk about how to improve our dance floors at our festivals and to really see, like, to really deconstruct how our dance floors mirror the default world. So let's break down the title of the talk. Interactive intervention. Oh, whoops. I just remembered. I want to do land recognition, or we want to do land recognition first and a water blessing. So if we can all close our eyes and get into a comfortable position and really try to ground our feet with this land and take a deep breath in together. So we're on indigenous land. Kern County is indigenous land. Bakersfield is indigenous land. The original peoples of this land are the Yokuts and the Chumash people, and they've been here for thousands of years stewarding the lands. And in 1776, the Spanish arrived as invaders, and they began colonizing this land. So, moving forward in our talk, may we take into consideration that how we treat the dance floor on indigenous land matters, and that when we engage on the dance floor, we are repairing all the harm that has been done. And so we think of our acts on the dance floor as prayerful in the act of decolonization. Thank you. And with that, RAZMA is gonna do a water blessing for us.
I come from a people from Lietuva, Lithuania, which means land of rain. And we were also displaced by war. And although this is a thing that many may consider sad, the beauty of it is that the waters still unite us all as people. The same blood that flows through our veins is that of the earth's waters as well. And so I give gratitude for the waters that unite us in our breath and in our blood and in all of our juicy fluids. And may our waters flow pure, clear, and strong and unite us together in one ocean of emotion. Thank you to the waters. Achu. Stay hydrated, friends.
Yay! Thank you, RAZMA. Okay, so to unpack the title, by interactive intervention, the way I think about it is that, you know, the world's a stage and we are all actors. So we are constantly improvising when we are confronted with an unprecedented situation that we may not have been prepared to handle. We're always in a state of emergence, and what we can do is we can prepare ourselves to be interactive when we don't feel like we've ever been ready to address something. And if we think about festivals and we think about the dance floor, especially in these really avant-garde spaces, we're really on the vanguard here, and we're really in a liminal space between the old ideologies that came with colonization to these lands and utopia, where we could be headed if we put in that work to decolonize our hearts, our minds, our behaviors. And so the dance floor and festivals become the stage in which we are all actors to use our agency to decide what kind of world we're creating, what kind of world we're modeling. And it, for me, it starts on the dance floor and how we treat each other on the dance floor, on indigenous land, and how we treat each other. And so during psychedelic and sexual emergencies on the dance floor, do you feel inspired to take it away and unpack some of that, or do you want to add up to that?
Definitely. I have over 15 years work in harm reduction, and I hold ceremony space where I have a lot of control over the environment, where people come into a container that I've created. And here on the dance floor, I like to think of it more as the wild. You know, we're in the wild and we're exploring the flora and fauna of this new place. And it's good to come into a space with the eyes of someone who is a respectful tourist in some ways. So knowing that you are visiting this place, and at the same time that you're a representative of the best aspects of this new emerging culture. So I would say a beautiful first principle to start with is to observe. Observe what's happening around you. Be aware of the energies that are moving in the space and what's happening. And a lot of harm reduction is aided simply by your awareness. You know, first, just find out what's going on. Find out what's going on within yourself. What would serve your highest and brightest expression? And then from that place of abundance, you can look around you and see how you might be able to aid those around you. I'm vouching for a return to this idea of rave moms and dads and people within the community looking out for each other, because that's what we are. We're a community of care for each other. And we are each other's social safety net. We're weaving it together. And so bring your particular way of being in the world, your persona, your character is valuable, and bring it forth in a spirit of help to anywhere that you may find yourself roaming.
So something that reminded me of is the culture of plur. How many of you all in here know what plur is? Can I see by a show of hands? Awesome. Okay, for those of us who know it, do you want to say the full, like, what plur is on three, and we can all do it in unison, in unity? Okay. One, two, three. Peace, love, unity, respect. Wow, that was cool. So the Peace, Love, Unity, Respect movement started out as Plum, when it was the Peace, Love, Unity movement. And it emerged, and we keep saying emerged because, you know, there's this really rad writer, activist, healer, Adrienne Marie Brown. And she's written Emergent Strategy and Pleasure Activism. Highly recommend those reads to everyone. And just want to, you know, give recognition to who's inspired us to talk about the state of emergence. So, okay, so the rave culture started blossoming in the late 80s and the early 90s, and there was this party in New York, and someone punched someone, and first it was the Peace, Love, Unity movement, and then there was this fight that broke out at a rave in New York, and one of the DJs was like, uh-oh, look, we can't have fighting at our raves, like, we have to add respect to the Peace, Love, Unity movement, and that's how the Peace, Love, Unity movement became the Peace, Love, Unity, Respect movement in the 90s, in the early 90s, and so that's how Plum went from Plum to Plur. And what that reminded me of is that Plur is what we could be if we decolonized. And what I really want to remind us to do when we're here at this festival, and remind other people to do, is to train ourselves in the situational awareness that I remember so clearly when I first started attending raves, where we could be super, super, super transcended in our psychedelic states and still feel safe. And I recognize that hasn't always been the case for people at raves, like even when I was feeling that way at raves. But I first started attending raves because I felt super free on the dance floor. I felt free from the gender-based sexual violence I was experiencing in the default world, especially when entering those transcendent states. But when I came into the awareness that the dance floor was resembling a battlefield, and that I still felt like my energy was being preyed upon and extracted in the same way that the earth is extracted by the extractive industries, I started to feel unsafe on dance floors, and I started attending raves and festivals at a very young age, and so I became super nostalgic for this idealization of what Plur could be, but what I wasn't seeing. And so my journey in pleasure activism is to really challenge us to really bring the Plur to the dance floor and be observant to what's happening. And something that I remember is that we could be high as the sky on the dance floor, and people would be checking up on each other. Like, we would be like, are you okay? Do you need something? And like, when we would be in those states, it was more like, how can I be of service to you? What do you need? Like, do you need gum? Do you need water? It was more like people started conversations by offering water, offering something, rather than expecting or trying to do something that was more like assuming of like what would be going down if someone was dancing or dressed a certain type of way, as if it were an invitation for anything more than being of service.
Yeah. There's a beautiful consent principle that I created and write about called invitation without expectation. And it's an extension of an offering that's a genuine gift without attachment to the outcome. And there's also this beautiful concept of consent as intent. So if we can get really clear with each other about what our desires and our expectations are about any particular interaction, we can then find our match, we can be on the same page. So to either be clear and have your intent expressed, and that's what consent is to me, or to be in the spirit of the gift, to be, you know, in that place where you're giving without attachment to the outcome.
I love that. And that reminds me of in Emergent Strategy by Adrian Marie Brown, she talks a lot about biomimicry and how our social movements for justice, for decolonization, should model species that have proven to be resilient. And so something I really want to encourage people to bring into the dance floor is biomimicry, especially when you have an intent to connect with someone, if that's your intent when you're on the dance floor. And that, for me, feels safer if people, for example, make an offering or perform a little mating dance. Like, it depends, like maybe you want to dress yourself in a particular kind of way. We can think of how some birds, you know, they do the little mating rituals where they do a little dance, they have really colorful feathers, and that's sometimes how we connect with people. Like, some people's feathers are like that gothy look, and other people's feathers are like animal print. And then also with the Peace, Love, Unity, Respect movement, there was those candy bracelets, right? And sometimes people, how many people traded candy in here? Can we get a show of hands? Shout out to candy. Can we bring candy back to the festival scene? Like, why did it become like distasteful somehow? Or like, I don't see it as much. But basically, that's a way to open up dialogue with someone. If you want to connect, you can trade candy, you can offer a gift. And then you can also do a little dance or like ruffle your feathers and see if someone reciprocates. If it's a, like you said, a conversation.
Yeah. Mirroring is a great way to interact with someone on the dance floor. So let's say there's someone out in the wild of the dance floor that you see them moving and you are inspired and you want to interact with them. First, again, like trying to catch their eye is a good way. If they're really in their moment, though, too, that might not happen. But to mirror them and move as they are moving, to feel what it feels like in your body to move like them, is a great way to build resonance with someone. And they, at some point, if their eyes are open, might find you and see you. And, you know, they will see that you see them and that you're mirroring them in your movement. And resonance is the first way that we can build trust. And really, at the heart of all this, it's how do we build trust with each other and maintain the web of trust and have our reputations precede us in a good way, you know, on the dance floor and elsewhere. And so a great way to first interact with someone on the dance floor. Let's say you're right next to the speaker, you know, you're feeling that bass vibrate your body, is to mirror them and ask with your eyes, ask with your movements, and see if there's an invitation, you know? If they move towards you, if they continue to mirror with you and you're reflecting back at each other, you know, that's a good sign. If someone's moving away, turning away, you know, that's a sign that they're wanting to be with themselves at that time.
Yeah, and to add to that, that made me also think of how we should talk about redirecting energy if it's energy that doesn't resonate with us. And something I really, you know, want to invite people to do is to use props sometimes. Props can help with creating personal space. And for example, it was Thursday night and I was dancing and there was someone who had like a stuffed animal. It was like a dragon and they wanted to introduce me to their dragon. And I was dancing all sexy and I was like feeling myself. But I, you know, the dragon was cool and stuff. I happened to have a dinosaur puppet in my backpack, and I just felt like the dinosaur could really engage with the dragon in a way that empowered me to retain my erotic dancing. And so, like, I would love to invite people to embody silliness and to become a clown as a way to protect oneself. And that's what some indigenous communities have done to resist colonization, is to use humor to like reverse the gaze in a really like, in a way that dispels like the kind of energy that someone is trying to impose on oneself. So I like to, like, that's something that I've learned in the past few years, is to get super silly. I don't know if some of you all have seen Jenna Marbles's videos on like how to like dispel creepers and like make really crazy face like and I think that just totally like makes people disassociate with like where they were at, and like it kind of remixes the moment. So yeah, like having a little toy or puppet, or like knowing how to create your personal space. You can use tools like, I see a lot of people using light flow and poi to create personal space. I know for me, sometimes I get anxiety on the dance floor, but I still want to retain my feminine erotic power, because that's my creative power. And I feel like when I'm dancing on the dance floor, I'm in prayer. And for me, it's an erotic prayer, but I find myself in the paradox of not wanting to attract unsolicited sexual attention, but still wanting to gift that erotic creative energy as a collective prayer. And so for me, something that I've learned is that having roses or flowers or having certain movements and like really opening up the space. And I know RAZMA is very experienced in somatic therapy. So could you tell us more about somatic therapy and what you're talking about?
Oh gosh, I would love to. What a perfect segue. So another topic, you'll see me on the dance floor representing this, is that I teach twerk therapy. And, you know, I want to speak to the lineage of twerk as coming from Africa, from the Mapuka dance in the African diaspora to the Americas, and then being renamed twerk in the New Orleans bounce scene. So there's a strong lineage that comes from that. And it was my first social American dance form, believe it or not. Just happened to be where I went to school, and that's how it goes sometimes. But what I want to advance twerk as is a therapeutic modality. So in somatic-based therapies, what is the case is that we tap into our human animal body, and what animals do to dislodge trauma from their nervous systems is that they shake. For example, if there's a herd of deer and there is suddenly a predator, and the predator chases the herd, catches one of them, the rest get away, the remainder of the herd, when they get to a safe place, will shake to reset their nervous systems and dislodge the trauma of the fight or flight response. Now, we as human animals, for some reason, have not continued this in our culture, except through dance. And so what the dance floor can be is this beautiful place where we can gather as a collective and witness each other in shaking out our trauma. That is a beautiful thing that comes from this festival culture. And what it is it's group trauma release. And twerk is one of my preferred methodologies to shake it out. And, you know, it can be everything from erotic to clowning and all at once, actually, for me personally. That's just my personality. But I invite you to find how you shake it out on the dance floor. And this is why circles form around twerking, because there is energy being shaken out of the body and returned to the earth to be recycled as something new. And so please, like, hold space for that. Hold space within yourself. Give yourself permission to shake it out. This is what we're here for. Yes! Shake it out. You know, make noise and just, it's, I mean, what a blessing to be able to gather in such a sacred way.
Yes.
You know? Let's return to our human animal selves together.
Yes. Such a blessing. And so that we can take something with us and also share it with our friends, I really want to, you know, talk about this parallel of the dance floor to land and our planet, our shared planet, and to continue addressing trauma, right? Collective intergenerational trauma and how that plays out on the dance floor, and how we can really work towards giving each other permission to shake off our traumas. Because if we act a certain type of way on the dance floor, we're not truly giving each other permission for that freedom to release our traumas. So I really want to build this analysis with you all around the 19th article of the UN Declaration of Indigenous Peoples' Rights. So this year I'm really trying to promote the 19th article of it because it's 2019, so I feel like it's numerically aligned to do so. And I would love for you all to continue this conversation, especially going into 2020. Let's be futurist here, right? So the 19th article is around the consultation with indigenous communities, indigenous leaders of indigenous territories, if there is an intention to enter the land, to transform the land, to engage with the land, we always need to ask for permission. And then it's a process of consulting and reaching consent, which is agreement, and being in relationship and dialogue, ongoing dialogue with each other. And then cooperation is that we are in alignment with the agreement, we honor the agreement, we continuously check in about the agreement. And right now, like, something that I see on the dance floor and that really concerns me and sometimes triggers psychedelic and sexual emergency on the dance floor while I'm trying to shake off my trauma. So I'm like, one step in the shaking off the trauma is one step over here, like, oh shit. but we got a lot of stuff to do. Sometimes I feel like we're really regurgitating the wounds of our society on the dance floor. And I know that there are microaggressions and triggers happening on the dance floor, and everything's happening so fast in our minds, you know, on so many different planes at once at times. And sometimes I'm concerned. Like, I know that some of my friends that aren't here would be triggered by some of the stuff we see on the dance floor, and for some people it may be cool, but for other people we're not there yet. Like, we can't talk about, like, whether it's okay to embrace another culture by wearing their symbols when we're not doing our homework in decolonizing and really taking initiative to repair the harms of 500 years of colonialism and slavery.